Our thanks to the stalkers for sharing their garden with us. It's always lovely to see. Thank you so much for opening your garden gates. Right now, we're going to be talking about Native Plant Week and incorporating native plants into our garden. I'm joined by Cathy Downs from the Native Plant Society of Texas, and it's great to have you with us.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Now, I know you're real involved in a variety of different things when it comes to native plants, and especially when it comes to monarch butterflies. And we'll be saving that for a little bit later in the program. But I want to talk about kind of expanding the way we think about our native plants. Everybody thinks of them as being smart choices now because of drought and because they're well adapted. But they have so many uses for wildlife. They are very, very beneficial. But it's really important to think of them as four-season kind of additions to the garden, right?
It's true. If you consider that native plants and wildlife evolved together on the planet and actually adapted to service each other to the best success.
Right.
And when European settlers came in and started to disrupt or put in non-native and invasive plants, we began to see right away a loss of wildlife. So native plants, to me, their key priority is to keep the wildlife habitat together. We're losing about 6,000 acres a day in Texas alone to development. So we have that habitat loss as well. Anything that we can do on a home level to help bring native plants back into a habitat area is going to be very useful. One of the great benefits, I think, of native plants is, one, conservation of water, certainly. In a drought period, these plants have developed and adapted to tolerate droughts and other extreme climate issues. So when we're planting native plants, not only are we assuring that the soil will be protected even during times of drought, we're conserving water. The other things that we're doing is helping to promote public health, because native plants don't require the fertilizers, the pesticides, and the other things.
None of them run off into our streams.
That's absolutely right. So it's a public health concern as well, not using native plants.
Right. So there are obviously many benefits to the use of native plants. And, you know, I love the notion of bringing what's, you know, our native material into the backyard, in part because, you know, I've heard people talk about this kind of poetic concept of create a national park in your backyard.
Right.
You know, that if everybody adopted native plants and we all did this and it stretched across all those suburban spaces, it would be effectively creating like cities in parks. You know, and I think that's a really wonderful concept.
It is a wonderful concept. You know, the nursery varieties that were so popular during the 50s and 60s and during the 70s and 80s, we saw a real return to conservationism, if you will, and that's when native plants really started to take the front stage again. I think that in terms of native plants, if you really want to create a diversity, you want to create a wildlife habitat for yourself, you can do it in a very tiny space, and every little bit helps. The plant roots from native plants are aerating the soil. They're creating a better microenvironment below the soil. So your food web continues on at a better pace. You have the microorganics underneath the soil. The insects are going after those. The birds are going after the insects, and the food web goes up. These are all adaptations. In four seasons, you have different life cycle needs for your animals. For instance, the birds. The birds need to nest.
Right.
So they have to find proper nesting material. Some birds require only a certain material to nest.
They can be pretty particular.
They are very particular. They're even particular where in the landscape they choose to nest, whether it's in the low area, the mid area, or the high canopy. So when you're thinking about putting native plants into your garden, you want to think about the four elements that are so important: food, shelter, water, and space.
Okay.
And those things should all be, they should all be given to the landscape design.
Well, and this is a great time to be thinking about it. Native Plant Week is coming up, appropriately in the fall, because fall is a perfect time for planting in Central Texas.
It's true. In the fall, the cooler weather, for one thing, certainly makes us happier to be out in the garden. And along with that, fall is a great time to start your perennials. It gives them several months to actually establish a root system, put up a little bit of a rosette or a little bit of cover over their root system that's going to protect them from frost. And you'll see them come back and thrive in the spring.
Yeah, give them a head start on the summer, next year, summer.
Absolutely.
You know, it's always a good idea, I think.
Well, and you have water needs that aren't going to be as pressing. when you're planting in the fall.
So. Right, right. You know, and hopefully we'll get a little rain in the fall, right?
I hope so.
Keep our fingers crossed.
Were you lucky enough to get some of that rain recently? We got 3 inches out there in Hill Country.
Well, good for you. Well, let's talk, you know, I know you're passionate about creating monarch way stations, mm-hmm. and this is, you're actually heading up the state committee on this for the Native Plant Society. What is the concept all about? How can somebody who doesn't have kind of a green thumb or a native mm-hmm. plant in their yard kind of adopt this idea and get going?
Well, that's a really good question. Monarchs are kind of a brand, and mm-hmm. and people recognize and understand monarchs. They have very great memories as children of monarchs flying
sure.
through.
They and have a fan base.
They're kind of a brand and mm-hmm. a great indicator for pollinators in mm-hmm. general. So what we're trying to do, because monarch populations are decreasing, is to offer monarchs a stopping by place. Mm-hmm. Now, the requirements are very minimal for a monarch way station. There is no minimum requirement to certify mm-hmm. as a monarch way station. So as little as 3 milkweeds, and that would be the key here, is the milkweeds. The monarch butterfly is one of the animals that never adapted to any other host plant other than the milkweeds. So their mm-hmm. larvae can only feed on milkweed, and we've lost millions of acres mm-hmm. of milkweed habitat. So the first thing you would want to do is to understand your regional milkweeds, mm-hmm. and even an assortment of milkweeds is a good idea, that you have one to back up the other. So when you put in several different varieties of milkweed, then you're blooming at a certain time and your right. larvae are coming in at a certain time. When the monarchs are flying north, it's crucial for them to have the milkweed in Texas. We're in the central Texas flyway.
Sure.
And our milkweed habitat determines what that summer breeding population is going to be. So okay. it will have an effect in the fall. Mm-hmm. The thing you want to do is to have a couple of nectar plants. And okay. the reason for this is that monarchs need to sustain themselves over right. several months in the winter. So they need right. those fat contents.
Right. And when they're actually migrating back to the south of us, they need that nectar as well.
Absolutely right.
Right. So and you mentioned the milkweeds. And actually, people now are marketing what they call milkweed bombs and things like that. It's really become quite a national sensation, which is very encouraging, I think.
It has, and we're really hoping, I mean, a lot of native plant sales now are beginning to provide milkweed on the plant sales. The difficulty is finding and propagating milkweed seed. Mm-hmm. It's not an easy thing to propagate, but once it's in the ground, you'll never have to worry about it again. So there are seeds and plants available at native plant sales. Mm-hmm. I know the Wildflower Garden is putting sure. a plant sale on. You can get seed from Native American Seed and Junction. Mm-hmm. And once your milkweed is in the ground, it is perennial. It mm-hmm. will go underground for a brief time during the summer and reemerge in the fall.
Okay.
Its blooms are great nectar plants
sure.
in addition. So at least 3 of those in any container even would be sufficient.
Real briefly, how do people get involved in the Native Plant Society?
Well, you could go right directly to the website, mm-hmm. which is www.npsot.org. You could find a chapter in your area. There are some 47 mm. chapters,
great.
I think, currently.
Great.
So there'll be a chapter in your area. Some of these chapters even bring visitors to your home to tell you what you have there
cool.
and what might be useful for you to use.
Okay. Well, we applaud your efforts and
thank
hope
you.
People will be adopting native plants and
so
creating those way stations in their backyards. It's always great to talk about native plants. Thanks so much for sharing your information with us.
Thank you for having me here.
All right, Cathy. And coming up next is our friend Daphne.